Singing number 23, worthy of worship. Let's stand together as we sing. Sustainer, you are worthy, worthy and wonderful, worthy of worship and praise. Please remain standing for opening prayer.
Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are indeed worthy, Lord. You are our Creator, you are our Father, Lord. You are our Lord, our God, and our King, and we're thankful for that, Lord. We're thankful that you saw fit in your perfect sovereignty to reveal yourself to us, Lord, to make a plan from even before the foundation of the world, Lord, for our souls, that you would make a plan to save us, and we thank you for that, Lord, and Lord, we just thank you for the love and the grace and the mercy that you show us. And Lord, we're thankful that we can come here today and just sing praises to you and study your word and just open our hearts and our ears and our minds, Lord, to you. And as you have taught us, Lord, that we should love the Lord our God with all our souls, with all our hearts, with all our minds, with all our strength, Lord. And in doing that, Lord, that we love our neighbors as ourselves, and we thank you for that. Lord, just help us. Help us to always do that, to demonstrate our love for you through our love for others. And Lord, we just ask your blessing on all that's done here this morning. In Jesus' holy and precious name, amen. You may be seated. We are in John chapter 8, reading verses 31 through 47. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, If ye continue in my word, then ye are my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth forever. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. I know that ye are Adam's seed, but ye seek to kill me, because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said unto them, if ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me. A man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of God, this did not Abraham. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, ye would love me. For I proceedeth forth and come from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech? Even because ye cannot hear my word. Ye are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Which of you convicteth me of sin? And I say the truth, why do ye not believe me? He that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God.
The most recognizable line, perhaps, and perhaps the most impactful phrase in our song of the month is found in the chorus. It says, your will cannot lead me where your grace will not keep me. It was God's will for Paul to have his thorn in the flesh. Paul did not want it, and he asked for it to be removed. God's answer was plainly his grace was sufficient for Paul to bear this burden, and so it is with us. Wherever God's will leads us, we can rest secure. We can rest assured that his grace is there to keep us from falling, to sustain us through the time that has been charted by his hand. Let's stand together as we continue to learn our song of the month, Grace. Lord, as I seek your guidance for the day, I find my thoughts unyielding, confusion crowds my way. But then when I bow to you, the challenges you guide me through, your promises are ever new. I claim them for today. Your will cannot lead me where your grace cannot keep me. Your hand will protect me. I rest in your care. Your eyes will watch over. worshiping now with number 599, Before the Throne of God Above.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is Love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his form. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. On him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect, spotless righteousness. Changeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my sinful soul's his blood is won. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God.
Welcome everyone this morning. Good to have everybody out today. I do have a couple of announcements I need to go over today. Vacation Bible School is coming up very shortly, just the end of the month. We were short a couple of people, and the Lord has already provided a couple more people that told me they'd be willing to serve. Yesterday they told me, which I'm just really thankful for. So we're in a little bit better shape now for Vacation Bible School, and God has provided. And actually, there's a few churches in the area that might be sending a couple of people to help as well. So that'll be a blessing. I want to make an announcement about a very short meeting right after the service. Anybody who be interested, okay, there it is. Anybody who might be interested in helping with the audiovisual computer kind of stuff in the back, we want to. Some of these guys have families. We want to let them sit with their families and that kind of stuff every once in a while anyway. And so we'd like to be able to get a few more people involved in that ministry. And so if you're in any way interested in that ministry, would you meet just back? It'll be 5 minutes. It won't take five, maybe 10 minutes if there's questions or something. But just head to the back after the service, and we can kind of get the ball rolling and get a schedule up. Pat will be leading. Pat and Eric basically will be leading that up. So I encourage you to head back there and find out more about the needs and opportunities that might be there. Also, we have a Vacation Bible School sign-up sheet snack list in the lobby there. And if you're able to help out with various snacks during the week, that would be a really good thing. So I encourage you to do that. I need to talk about a need in our church that is something that's going to be reoccurring. Of course, it has been and will continue. One of the things that I'm really convinced of, just personally, and my own minute, and the Lord has led me in ministry to think this way, is that God provides where He wants us to do something, and if He doesn't provide, it means we're not supposed to do something. That's very, very simple. The preaching of God's word is the thing that needs to always be there, and there's some sort of essentials in the ministry that are necessary. And there are other things that are really helpful in helping with discipleship that are also close to necessary, but may not be. And so I just, when I say this, I I just want to say that's sort of my heart on it. I want people to be led by God's Spirit to do what God would have them to do and when they hear of particular needs. But this is sort of one of those things where if we don't have the help, we'll have to not do it. And it's one that would be maybe a hindrance to our worship service, to be honest with you. And that has to do with Junior Church. We have been able to fill the slots for 6 months, but we're kind of up here July. We need to be able to fill the schedule for the next 6 months. Our goal has been to sort of hopefully get 12 different families to sign up to help with this, 12 different couples, and so that nobody has to do it twice. But unfortunately, we're not at that place where we can do that. In fact, we actually have less people that are so far that have been willing to help with Vacation Bible or with help with Junior Church this coming year than we did the previous years, our year that we done it last year. And so here's what I just need you to do. Anybody who's ever been involved with helping with Junior Church, Carol is going to send out a letter this coming week, probably Tuesday. And I need you just to prayerfully consider helping out in this ministry. If the Lord does not want you to, don't do it. And if the Lord doesn't provide the right amount of people, then we don't have Junior Church, basically. We just have everybody in here. That's just kind of where we're at with it. And so that means that we're essentially going to be asking some people to double up to do it twice. And some people have already offered to do that, which we're very thankful for. So it's just kind of one of those things where it's, you know, every ministry is a faith ministry. We just trust the Lord to provide where he wants to provide, and we do what he wants us to do. So I wanted to let that need be known to you and just be ready for an email. If you could respond as quickly as possible, July is coming up here, and to Carol's email, that would be very helpful. And I'm not really trying to push anybody to do something that the Lord doesn't want them to do. I want the Lord to lead, and we'll just go based upon God's leading as far as what we have. God has always been faithful to our church to provide, and everybody's working hard and serve. Most people are working hard and serving, and in no way do I want to put extra pressure on people, and I don't want you to feel pressured about this. The Lord will provide the way he wants to. So just go according to God's leading, and we'll see what the Lord does in provision. All right. Please be in prayer for Vacation Bible School. We do have a lot of people signed up for that, and we're looking forward to having a great week at the end of the month. The other thing I need to let you know about is we are combining community home groups for the summer. We'll have Glen Burnie and Pasadena groups combined together, as well as Odenton and Annapolis will be combined together. The addresses of where those locations are in your bulletin. And so make sure the Griffins are going to be, it'll be held tonight at the Griffins, and it'll be held, and the Summerdorfs. Yes? Oh. All right, well, let's just do it at the Parsonage tonight then. That's the good backup. So, okay. So if you're in Glen Burnie or Pasadena group, just meet here. The Parsonage is right in the back there, and we'll do it in there. And I'll be at that group tonight. And if you don't know what group you're in, the default is Glen Burnie. The default is here, basically. And so just meet back here tonight if you don't know where else you're going. And we'll work those details out. So the Parsonage, we'll do the Parsonage tonight. All right, let's go ahead and have the gentleman come forward for the offering. If you're a guest here with us, we hope that you're very... We feel very welcome in our church. That is our desire. And if you would fill out a visitor's card for us, just let us know we have a record of your attendance. That would be great. We'll get a letter out to you, Lord willing. And so if you could do that for us, that would be great. You should be in the back of the chair in front of you or in the packet that you received as you came in. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you and thank you for who you are today, and we thank you that Christ is the Word. He is the revealed Word of God to us. We thank you that he provides freedom for us, that there is great freedom in Christ. And as we learn what that freedom is today, I pray that you would help us to experience freedom in Christ. Lord, you've provided for anybody who knows Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. You have provided this for us, and yet we admit before you that sometimes we don't experience the freedom that you've provided. And so if there's anybody today who doesn't know you, they've never actually experienced freedom in Christ, I pray today would be a day that you would work in their hearts and in their lives, that you'd bring them to a place where they understand their sin and their need of a Savior, that Christ satisfies your demands so that they could be rightly related to God. And if there's anybody here also, or that is not, if we're not experiencing the freedom that we can have in Christ, I pray today would be a day that we would understand how to do that effectively according to your word. We thank you for the time that we can spend together worshiping you today, and we pray all of these things in Christ's name. Amen.
For our final song before the message, we'll sing Glory to His Name, number 303 actually in our hymnal, Glory to His Name. Let's stand together as we sing, and children at this time can be dismissed to junior church.
Plunging
be seated.
John chapter 8 this morning. John chapter 8, and we're looking at verses 31 through 47. I want to begin by asking you to imagine you were born in a prison. Not only were you born in a prison, but you grew up in a prison, and you went into adolescence, you were still in that prison, and then when you became an adult, you remained in that prison. One day, as you were living in that prison, somebody came to you and said to you, "Hey, you're in a prison." And you said, "Well, yes, so, okay." And they said to you, "You can be free." Now, just imagine, you don't know what freedom is. You've always been in a prison. That's all you know. You've born there. You've lived there. You went into adulthood there. That's all you ever know. Do you think it's possible that you would say, "What do you mean, be free?" If you really think about it, that is the way our world is. Our world, those who don't know Christ as their Savior, are not free. They are living, in a sense, in a prison. They think they're free, but they're not free. And the reason that they're not free is because they don't know that they're not free. And the reason that they don't know that they're not free is because they've never experienced freedom. This is a passage where Jesus is going to explain that he, as the Son of God, is able to make them free. And we're going to run into a group of people here in this passage who question whether or not they're free. They think they are free. And Jesus has to say to them, "I am the Son of God, and I can set you free." But beyond that, folks, isn't it true that sometimes we as Christians get caught up in the same problem? We may know Christ as our Lord and Savior. He may have redeemed us from our sin. We may be positionally right with Him, but we get caught up in our sin, and it becomes so comfortable to us that we don't realize we're in bondage and we're not experiencing Christ's freedom. You know that that is possible. That although God, Christ, has made you free, you're not experiencing Christ's freedom. And so today, as we look at God's Word, we're going to look at what it means for Christ to make us free. Both those who know Christ as their Savior, or don't know Christ as their Savior, which this passage is primarily intended for. But also, folks, the reality is we as Christians can get into a place in our lives where we're not experiencing the freedom that Christ offers. Before we get into all of that, let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask His blessing on our time together. Father, we come to You and we thank You for this passage that You have given to us by inspiration of Your Spirit. We thank You that Christ communicated the way He did to make it very clear what true belief is. And I pray, Lord, today that You would help us to become grounded when it comes to this matter of acceptable belief versus unacceptable belief, and to understand what true biblical freedom is, and to understand what is really necessary in order for us as Christians to experience this freedom. Lord, I pray that You would just help us today as we go through Your Word to glean what You would have us to glean, and we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, we're picking up here in verse 31. Last week, we looked at a passage of Scripture that ended with verse 30. And verse 30 told us that there were a group of people that Christ was talking to, and the people, it says, believed. And so they professed belief in Christ. But it's interesting, as we've seen other times in the book of John, that not every time somebody says they believe in Christ is it true, sustainable belief. In fact, in this passage, we're going to find that the people that Christ is talking to, they may have some sort of belief, but is not sustainable belief. We might call it fickle faith.
And what we find in the passage is that these are people whose faith is fickle. They want to believe to an extent, but when the time gets hard or when there are things that they disagree with or when things get difficult, then their faith is no longer going to be there. And Christ understands that their faith is not sustainable faith, and because he understands this, he is going to deal with the heart of the problem. He's going to help them to understand that he can make them free, but they are currently not free because they don't have true acceptable belief. In fact, I'd like you to just note I'll refer to a passage of Scripture. You can turn there if you want to, but in John chapter 22, verses 23 through 25, we've seen the same kind of thing before when it came to a different group of people. It says in that passage that many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. But verse 24 says, and Jesus did not commit himself unto them because he knew all men. And he needed not that any should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. They had seen in that passage him doing many miracles and many great works, and they had some semblance of belief, but he did not believe their belief. He did not commit himself to them because their belief was a belief that was not sustainable belief. It was that belief that was really just there for a moment and gone tomorrow. And Christ, of course, because he knows the hearts of people, he knows the difference. The truth of the matter is, we don't sometimes, do we? We don't always know the difference. We don't know always the difference between fickle belief, that belief that is not going to be sustainable, and that belief that will stand the test of time. And that's why, really, just by way of application, it is important for us to be careful not to affirm someone's profession too quickly. Someone may profess to know Christ, and that's wonderful if they do that. And they may begin to follow Christ. But it's really only as you observe someone constantly being faithful to the Lord that you begin to understand that they really know Christ. Now, that is not to question their original belief in Christ. If Christ has worked in their heart and they know Christ as their Savior, that's wonderful. But as far as our understanding of where somebody comes to Christ, what we find in this passage, frankly, is that not everybody that says they believe in Christ really does. And you know whether or not they have by whether or not their belief is sustained. You'll notice in the passage in verse 31 what it says here. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye, what does it say? Continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. He wants these people to understand that they are truly followers of Christ. They are indeed disciples if there is a condition, if you do what? You continue in my word. Now, he is not saying this. He is not saying that you need faith plus continuing in my word in order to be saved. He's not saying that. What he is saying is that if you truly do have saving faith, you will continue in my word. And so we understand this from this text. The word continue is quite interesting. It's the same word that's sometimes translated in the book of John, abide. Do you remember in the book of John where this concept of abide is? If you'll recall just from your own study, John chapter 15, you have all over the place in that book, or in that chapter, this concept of abiding in Christ. But it's not only there, it's in John chapter 5, verse 38, which says, and ye have not his word abiding in you, for whom he hath sent, him ye believe not. And in John chapter 6, verse 27, it says, labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which endureth. It's the same word, endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. John chapter 6, verse 56 says, he that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me. It's the same word, dwelleth. So this word enduring or abiding or dwelling in, that's this word continue in. And the reality is when somebody comes to Christ, they are indwelt by the Spirit of God to fulfill the obedience to God, and they are going to continue in the words of Christ. Now, that doesn't mean that they are sin, that they don't sin and they aren't disobedient. We all know that to be true if we know Christ as our Savior. But there is this general continuing in the word that you see in a true believer. And what Jesus is saying here in this passage is that you may say you've believed, but unless you continue in my word, you really have not experienced saving faith. But he wants them to understand exactly what this means and how this plays out. And he says this to him in Scripture. He says, verse 32, "And ye shall know what? The truth, and the truth shall set you free." He says, you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. What does he mean by that? Well, it's sort of interesting that you've heard that phrase many times before. Even in secular society, we have that phrase that'll float around, the truth will set you free. In fact, even in the CIA, in their if you go into their main building, in their lobby, written on the floor is this exact verse, the truth will set you free. And they mean by that, in that verse, they mean by that, that if the CIA is able to discover the truth, it will maintain freedom for the people, for the United States. But the reality is they've really taken that verse out of context. That's really not what the verse is talking about. The verse is not saying that if you discover all kinds of truth, that it will protect you and it will keep your freedoms free. It means something else entirely. What he is talking about, of course, in this verse, when he's talking about the truth, is he is talking about himself. We know that he says in John chapter 14, "I am the way, the what? The truth and the life. And no man comes to the Father but by me." So when he says you'll know the truth and the truth will set you free, he's really saying you will know Christ. If you continue in my word, you will then know me and I will set you free. Because I, Christ speaking, I am the truth. We find, for example, in John chapter 1, verse 14, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among them, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." And so we find that what Christ is saying is that if you have sustained faith, you're going to know the truth. And how do you know the truth has worked in your life? You're going to know because that truth is going to set you to freedom. Now, not only has truth been misinterpreted in our society, in fact, we're living in a society now where there's no absolute truth. And absolute truth is sort of whatever you feel it ought to be. But also this concept of freedom has really been twisted, hasn't it? You think of our country. And it seems as though as we observe the direction that our country is going, we observe that there seems to be only one moral code. The one moral code on the one hand is there is no absolute truth. Whatever you believe to be true is what is true for you. It's called relativism. But on the other hand, they have also twisted this concept of freedom. If you think of just current legislation, and I don't want to get into politics, that's really not why we want to be here at all, frankly. That's too discouraging. But when you consider what true freedom is, there have been certain Supreme Court rulings that have occurred recently. And the truth of the matter is they were said to have been one step forward, another step forward in freedom. It seems as though now the only morality in this country is this morality of freedom. That is something right or something wrong? Well, it depends on freedom. Whether it's free. If it makes you more free, then it's right. If it makes you more bound, then it's not right. That's why anybody should be able to use any bathroom they want to. In this kind of a mentality, because you wouldn't want to hinder somebody's what? Freedom. The problem, folks, is that they have got a real serious problem with what true freedom is. Not only have they redefined truth for it to mean what they want it to mean, but they have redefined this concept of freedom. Freedom is not the ability to do whatever you want. Freedom is the ability and the power to do what you ought. That's true freedom. And as soon as you remove the moral code from the equation of freedom, you no longer have freedom. You have a shift in liberty from one group to another, and you have bondage. what kind of freedom? So when the Jewish people that were hearing this heard this idea that if they'll that they'll know the truth and the truth will set them free, they number one more than likely thought to themselves, well, we already have the truth. We don't need to know the truth. We've got the truth. We're children of Abraham. We have the Pentateuch and we have the Old Testament. We already have the truth and we're already free. And that's exactly what they say in the next verse. You'll notice here in verse 33, they answered him, and we be Abraham's seed and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Now, it's sort of ironic that they say this. Because if you look at the history of the nation of Israel, they have been in bondage nearly for a lot of their existence. They were in bondage in Egypt, for example. And then they experienced freedom in the book of Judges and didn't do so well, did they? They started doing what every man did, what was right in their own eyes, and as you find in the book of Judges. And then you move for a long time, then they have kings, they have a little bit less freedom. And they have some victory in the beginning with David, and then they fall into great problems and difficulties. As you move into Solomon's reign, you have mixture of freedom and all that kind of thing. You have some sort of mixture of following the Lord, and then it just splits wide open from there, and you don't have freedom. And you have one king after another who leads God's people into idolatry. And then again, you have bondage with a Babylonian captivity. And then that turns into the Medo-Persian Empire and then the Greek Empire. And now when we come to this place, we have the Roman Empire. And they're still in bondage to the Roman Empire. How in the world, on what level are the Jewish people saying in this text that they've never been in bondage? It's almost as though they're delusional about this. Nearly their entire, well, not their entire history, but a lot of their history, they have been in bondage. They have not been free. And yet for some reason, they think they're free even though they're not free. And that is perhaps the most significant problem in our culture today. People think they're free and they're moving toward freedom. And they're doing the exact opposite. They're not. They're in bondage and they're moving toward more bondage. These people were in bondage. And you know why they're in bondage? Because they were depending upon Abraham, that being of the generation, the lineage of Abraham, and saying that is going to set us free. They were depending upon the wrong thing. We're going to see that more as we work through the passage. Jesus is going to reply in verse 34 when he says this. Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, whoever committeth sin is what? The servant of sin." What is the freedom that Christ is talking about? He is talking about freedom from sin. Freedom from sin. Now, let's just think about that for a moment. When people say that they are free, or that we are moving forward as a nation, or as individuals in their freedom, you may hear a teenager say that they want to be free. They want to feel experience freedom. If they could just have more liberty and they could have more less rules, they can be free. I heard this in college a lot. You know, we just have too many rules. If we could just be free. I'm not saying that there wasn't too many rules. There was quite a lot of rules. But they were depending upon less rules in order to experience freedom. And you move into a society, there's this desire for freedom. Freedom. We need freedom. And you know what the reality is? Freedom is a very dangerous thing, because you know what our hearts will incline us to do when we are free? Sin. They will incline us towards sin. Our hearts are deceitful and desperately wicked. And so if we experience freedom from bounds, freedom from rules, it may very well incline us toward freedom to do what we want. And folks, that's not freedom, that's bondage. And we live in a world today who is in bondage, enslaved to sin. And it says in this passage, whoever commits sin is enslaved to it. And it applies here that not only are we enslaved by the results of sin, but as we commit sin, it more and more enslaves us into it. But folks, isn't this true? It's not only a problem for those who don't know Christ as their Savior. If we're not careful, those of us who know Christ as our Savior and Christ has set us free positionally, we can choose not to experience the freedom that we have in Christ. I want to delve into this just for a few moments into a little bit more detail. I'd like you to take your Bibles and I'd like you to look at Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, we see this concept of freedom several times in this passage. And although we don't have a time to do a full exposition of this book or of this chapter, I do want us to note several observations that will help us to understand by way of application the kind of freedom that God wants us to experience. The reality is, biblically, true freedom results from death. And you say, well, that makes no sense at all. How can we experience freedom if we're dead? Well, look at what the passage says. He says, verse 4, for example, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also shall walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed or rendered inoperable, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Why? For he that is dead is freed from sin. There is a sense in which when somebody comes to Christ, the old man dies, so that the flesh, though it's still there and still resides in us, no longer has a controlling influence in our lives. Certainly a tempting influence, but not a controlling influence in our lives. And so he says here that the first step to experiencing true freedom in Christ is that you've got to be dead. And all people that know Christ as their Savior genuinely are dead in Christ and alive unto God. But folks, the reality is if we're not careful, we don't see ourselves that way. And number two, we find that freedom from sin must result in servanthood to righteousness. You see, the way that the scriptures describe this is that we're going to be enslaved to someone or to something. You're either going to be enslaved to sin or you're going to be enslaved to righteousness. You're either going to be enslaved to the world and Satan or you're going to be enslaved to Christ. The question is, which one do you want to be enslaved to? There is no possibility of being free from either one. But the reality is, when we are enslaved to Christ, all we experience is joy. The result of being enslaved to Christ is joy and peace. That's true freedom. Freedom from sin. And freedom to live righteously unto God. And we've got to understand our own thinking when it comes to sin. See, sin deceives us into thinking that if you indulge in that sin, you will be more free. And God says, no, no, if you indulge in that sin, you will become enslaved to it. True freedom is only in Christ alone, in righteousness, rather in sin. Now, I want us to see then, folks, that experiencing freedom requires us to yield our members to righteousness. Would you notice in the passage here, verse 19, I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye yielded your members servants to uncleanness and to iniquity into iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. For when ye were the servants of sin, ye were free from righteousness. What fruit had ye then in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now being made free from sin and become servants to God, ye have your fruits unto holiness and the end everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The way that God describes it is this: Jesus sets us free. He makes us free. He sets us free from the bonds of sin. But in order to experience that freedom that God desires us to experience, we have to render our members. Let me just put it this way very bluntly. We've got to render our body parts to Him. That's what it says in the passage. That really would include our minds, wouldn't it? It really would include our hearts. It really would include all of ourselves to Him for His service. And when we do that, we truly experience freedom. And folks, the problem with us is that we get caught in thinking that when we are indulging in sin, that we are actually experiencing freedom. It is a terrible place to be in. And when God chastens a person who knows Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, and He brings them back to a place where they are experiencing freedom again in Christ, and they are free from that sin that has entangled them, they look back and they say, wow, I am now free from this. They realize the freedom that they have in Christ, even though they had no idea that they were in bondage when they were experiencing that sin. It is the great danger of any Christian to think that what we really need is just to be able to do what we want. That's enslavement. What we need to be able to do is to have the ability to do what is right. The ability to do what is right, and that only comes through Christ. How? It comes as we continue and abide in His Word. Scripture is very clear about this. It tells us that my word have I hidden thy heart that I might not do what? Sin against thee. And so we find that Scripture says that when we abide in Christ, which we're going to detail out eventually, and when we abide in the Word of God, when we abide in these things, then we continue to experience the freedom that God gave us when we trusted Him as our personal Lord and Savior. Freedom is the power to do right. And we find that very clearly laid out in Scripture. Now, what we need to do then is understand what keeps us from this freedom, really what keeps the world from the freedom. And the answer to that is we're going to see extreme spiritual blindness. Do you realize that that is exactly the place where unbelievers are in? They are blind. Just like that person that is in prison that can't see what is right in front of them. And Jesus deals with their blindness in this way. Would you turn back with me to John chapter 8? And I'd like to pick up here in verse 35. Verse 35 says, "And the servant abideth not in the house of forever, but the Son abideth forever. For the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed." He uses an illustration here, and he says, a servant who is in a house. Now, this is something that we don't really have a lot of experience with. There are other cultures that do. When I went over to Hong Kong, they have something basically where they all of the people in Hong Kong work really, really hard, spend a lot of hours working. In order to take care of the house, they have servants that come in. Usually they're from the Philippines. And it's beneficial for the people from the Philippines because they're able to get, believe it or not, a higher standard of living than they have in the Philippines, even though it's not a great standard of living compared to what we would think. But they live in the house, and they have certain benefits from living in their house. This is actually very common in many places in our world, even in today. But it's not common in our Western civilization, particularly in our country. But this was common back then, and so he uses this illustration. He says, what is the difference between a servant and a son? A servant is temporary. A son is permanent. When they were depending upon Abraham to be able to get to God, they were depending upon something that was temporary. They were depending upon the servant of God rather than the Son of God. And he's trying to get them to understand that what they needed to do is depend upon the Son of God. They were depending upon something temporary, the servant of God, when they needed to depend upon Christ, who is permanent, the servant of God. And so he says, he explains this in this passage. But there is, we see in this text, a real problem. The reason that they cannot see who Christ really is, the reason, folks, is because they are completely blinded to him. And we see in verse 37 that Christ is now going to expose their problem and their blindness as their will. And it's very likely, as Christ is even saying these words, that in their hearts, in their minds, they are becoming so angry with him because he is exposing their need. They're becoming so angry with him that they want to put him to death. Have you ever talked with someone in a loving manner about their need for the Lord in their lives? And maybe they don't express it, or maybe they do, but you find out later that what wells up within them is anger. Why? Because they thought they were fine, and you just exposed their need. Even Christians can be this way. They thought they were fine, and you just exposed their need. And these people had their need exposed, their freedom taught them that they were not free, that they thought they were, and that they knew they had committed sin, and they had plotted right then and there in their hearts to put Christ to death. And Christ exposes their hearts, as only he can do. And he says in verse 37, I know that you are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me, because my word hath no place in you. He says, you have this heart, this anger inside of you right now, this welling up inside of you, and you want to kill me. You are plotting to kill me right now in your heart because you're so angry. He says, I know you're Abraham's physical seed, but you're plotting to kill me. He says, there's a reason for that. He says, my word doesn't really have a place in you. Now, you've said you believed, but really, my word has no place in your heart. And that's why right now, when I expose your actual need, you're ready to put me to death. You're ready to kill me. You're plotting to kill me. Then he says in verse 38, I speak that which I have seen with my father, and ye do which ye have seen with your father. Now, he's about to imply something that they're not going to like. Who is Christ's father? Well, his father is God. Who is their father? Well, they're saying it's Abraham. He's going to say, no, your true father is not Abraham. Would you notice what it says in verse 39? And he answered and said unto them, Abraham is our father. This is what they said to him. Abraham is our father. Jesus saith unto him, if ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me, a man that told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham. Now here's what he's saying. He's saying, you heard the truth from me, and you're choosing to reject it. When Abraham heard the truth from God, he accepted it. You're not doing what Abraham did. You're demonstrating by your actions that you are really not, at least in a spiritual sense, of the children of Abraham. Now, let me just pause and say this. This had become a very common dependency for the nation of Israel, that they, merely by the fact that they were born into Judaism, that they were born with Abraham as their descendants, that they had eternal life, and that they were rightly related to God. But it's interesting that the Bible, even in the Old Testament, didn't actually teach this. For example, we won't take the time to look at that because we're short on time, but in Genesis chapter 21, we find that even though Ishmael was from Abraham, what was physically from Abraham, it says in the passage that he was not spiritually from Abraham. And we find the same kind of thing in Romans chapters 9 through 13. For example, in Romans chapter 9, verse 7, it says, "Neither because ye are a seed of the Abraham are they all children, but in basic shall the seed be called." In Romans chapter 2, verse 28, it says this, "For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God." Jesus exposes this. He says, you may be physically of Abraham, but you're not spiritually of Abraham. And he's going to begin, this is perhaps the first time he's going to make sort of this distinction between being physically from Abraham and being spiritually from Abraham. There are some people in their own theology that will actually take this and run with this so much that they think that God is no longer, God is entirely done even in the future with the nation of Israel, that he is completely finished with them and that there will be no millennial kingdom, literal millennial kingdom in the future. The Bible is not teaching that at all, and we find plenty of evidence of that in the New Testament. But we do find in this passage that there is a distinction here and that Christ makes a distinction between being physically of Abraham and spiritually of Abraham, because those who are spiritually of Abraham will immediately, or they will accept Christ. They will receive Christ. And Romans chapter 4 and Galatians chapter 3 is going to explain that more, that Abraham believed God and it was accounted to them for righteousness. In a sense, certainly Abraham knew God through what he knew of Christ. And so anybody that was going to truly be of Abraham in that way was going to need to follow after Christ. And he's explaining some of this in his own thinking. Now, what he says here is this. He says, you're not of Abraham because you're not doing the same thing Abraham's doing. And he says in verses 43 through 44, he explains, he says, why do you not understand me? He says, you cannot receive my word. Why? Because you are of your father. Look at verse 44. You are of your father, the who? Wow, that's pretty sharp, isn't it? He's going to come right down and tell them, look, your father's not Abraham, your father's the devil. Now, how would that go over if you went tomorrow morning at work and went to somebody and said, your father's not who you think it is, it's the devil? Really, really wouldn't go over real well, right? But he is going to explain into detail what he means by this. He is going to say, he's going to basically say, number one, you've got the same volition. Verse 45, notice what he says. He says, and because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Verse 44 actually is where he says this. Ye are of your father, the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He says, the same desires that your father has, you have. Well, what is he speaking of specifically? The desire to kill Christ. You've got the same, he says, the devil wants to kill me and so do you. You've got the same desires. He says, he was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. He is going to explain here in this passage that the devil is the father of lying, and that he doesn't believe the truth. And in the same way, they are believing lies rather than believing the truth. He is exposing them to the nth degree the problem that they have and why they won't believe. It is because, in a nutshell, spiritual blindness, which they won't receive the word and they won't receive the truth because they're really of their father, the devil. Now, let me just pause and just mention this. When we're born of this world, we need to make sure we understand that God is not our father. Someone who is born of this world is born into sin. It couldn't be clearer in Romans chapter 2 and chapter 3. There is a sense in which the world and the devil is their father. Now, that's a very harsh saying, isn't it? That is not necessarily how I would recommend you begin with someone in your evangelistic purposes. Might be better to start with who God is and his holiness and then move to their sin before you say their father is the devil. But that is true. No wonder, folks, we have such spiritual blindness. No wonder it takes so much for someone to realize their sin and their lostness and their need of the Savior. And no wonder the gospel is so great when it reveals that to somebody. The Bible says in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power. You know, there's a real sense in which when you look at how sinful people are and how blindful we are all born spiritually, it's amazing that anybody comes to God. It's like a miracle that the gospel ever works. Why does it work? It's because it's so powerful. The gospel is the power, and Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and he does bring freedom. And this passage is clearly teaching this. And we find we're going to end this way in verses 46 through 47. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Verse 46. Which of you convinced me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do you not believe me? He that is of God beareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God. We have here just really clear biblical truth. Just in way of concluding this and working through this a little bit, I just want to reiterate a couple of things here. I want to ask you this question. Is your faith fickle, or is your faith sustainable? You know, it's really amazing when someone seems to understand the gospel, and it's amazing when they make a profession of faith. It's wonderful when that happens, or when it seems as though God is getting a hold of their hearts. But I would imagine that many of you can think of times in your life when you are working with someone in discipleship where it's like it doesn't seem to last very long. It really didn't seem to actually take hold in their lives. Didn't really seem to shape them and change them. Is your faith fickle, or is it sustainable? Number two, is spiritual blindness keeping you from seeing your enslavement? Does it keep you from seeing your enslavement? Now, folks, I'm really talking here about somebody that really may think they know Christ, but they really don't. That is a very dangerous place to be in. It's always a dangerous place to be when you are in a state where you don't realize you're in. For an unsaved person, for them to think that they're saved when they're really lost, it's a very dangerous state to be in. For a saved person to think that they are spiritually mature when they're really not, or to think that they are living righteously when they really aren't. It is a very dangerous thing to be in a place where you aren't where you think you are, or where you are where you aren't. And I would just ask you the question, where are you in your life with the Lord? Number three, are you experiencing true freedom in Christ? Is there something in your life that you don't want to, it's hindering you. It's a weight to you. It's something that is besetting you. According to Hebrews chapter 12, we find that to be the case. I mean, there's things like that do, and they weight you down, and they cause you bondage in sin, and you think that if you get rid of them, you will be in bondage and you won't be free, but it's exactly the opposite that is the case. You've got to believe what God's word says about your sin. And so do I, don't I? We're all here together. We've got to identify sin as God does. The Bible says if you walk in the light as he's in the light, You'll have fellowship with one another. But if you say you have no sin, you deceive yourself and the truth is not in you. When we have sin and we deceive ourselves and think we don't, we are walking, the Bible says, in darkness. We've got to come to a place where we say, my sin is causing me no longer to experience God's freedom. I've got to sober up to this. And we need to confess it before the Lord, agree with God about it, and begin to experience the freedom in Christ that God wants us to experience in life. I'd like all of us just to pray for just a couple of minutes here. It won't take a long time. But we've gone over a lot of material here. And I think it's just helpful for us as we contemplate God's Word to ask ourselves the question, are we free? Are we experiencing biblical freedom with the power to do what is right? Is there some sort of sin or something in our lives that is keeping us from experiencing the freedom that God wants us to receive? And I'd just like you to take just a moment of silence before the Lord. Just take a few minutes, just a minute or two, and just ask the Lord to help you with this. Maybe the Lord has revealed something in your mind or in your heart that really is causing you not to be able to experience the freedom that God wants you to have. Or maybe there's somebody here that you really realize, you know what, I don't think I really know God. I don't know God through Christ. And if that's the case, you can experience freedom today through understanding and believing who Christ is and what he has done in dying on the cross for you. And if you're in that, if you are realizing today that you don't know Christ, would you come and talk with me or contact me or talk with somebody else that you're comfortable with that you're sure knows Christ, and we will be able to take a Bible and show you how you can be sure that you know Christ and that you experience the freedom that Christ offers to everyone who will accept it by faith. Just take a few moments and pray in silence before the Lord. Father, we thank you for the freedom that we have in Christ. It is promised to us who believe and who have sustaining belief in him. And it is clearly your desire for us to experience the freedom that you've given us. And we admit before you that our hearts are deceitful and desperately wicked, and we fall into the trap of thinking that we are in bondage when we are, of thinking that we are free when we're really in bondage. We thank you, Lord, for your word, and we thank you for your care for us that will always, eventually, in your time, bring us back to a place of freedom. But I pray, Lord, it is my heart's desire for myself and for all of us that we would catch sin at its early movements, that we would realize at the earliest stages of sin's deception in our lives, that we would catch it and we would realize that it is offering pseudo-freedom rather than true freedom, and that we would love freedom in Christ so much that we would keep from falling in to that kind of sin. We have many traps, many sins, many things that can trip us up. We know this, Lord, and I pray that you would help us to remain consistent in your word and faithful to to Christ's purposes. And we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.